Let us give thanks together for the great mystery, which is the Nativity, the entrance of God into our world among us. Welcome, everyone. Welcome longtime friends and friends just today. Welcome people who have traveled long distance to be here, and those who have come from just down the street. Now that we are all together, we are like one family, joined together in worshiping God. For this night, we are brother and sister in Christ's love together, and so let us worship. This evening's worship service explores the beauty and mystery in symbolic language, in poetry, looking at this familiar story as it has so many more layers than the surface with which we are familiar. As you look through the bulletin that you have in your hand tonight, you will see many opportunities where you are invited to read words and sit with words and experience the poetry and wonder of this day, of this festival day. So welcome. Our opening hymn tonight is called On Christmas Nights. It's number 3064 in your green book. When you find the number, I invite you to stand and sing with joy.
Maker of earth and heaven above.
God's name the worship due. Bring your best gifts to the throne. Our Lord is all holy. Tremble before him. Clothed in his beauty, come to adore him. Tell what God has done for you. Joy,
joy,
joy in the heavens.
Joy for the life of sea and earth. Joy in the field and the wood. Welcome God's kingdom. Praise our salvation. Now he is coming, Lord of creation, judging the peoples with his truth.
Let us sing for joy. He is born, number 228. Open yourselves to the newness in the story. In your bulletin, you'll find a poem printed. The heading is Nativity Poem. I invite you to spend a few moments in silence. You may read the poem to yourself or open your mind to wonder, letting go of all of the things that you're carrying from the way here tonight as we open up for the new story. Let us be in the spirit of praying. Anxiety in your heart. Flick it between your fingers and let it go. Where there is rushing in your mind, flick it between your fingers and let it go. Where there is fear jangling your nerves, flick it between your fingers. Let it go. Where there are problems for you to solve, pluck them between your fingers and let them go. Where there are old gripes and grudges weighing on your shoulders, pluck them between your fingers and let them go. Holy God, help us to be truly here. Help us to be open to your word within our words. Help us to see and hear and know with the senses that you bring and not our own. Amen. It is the evening of the birth of God. Singing and with gold instruments, the angels bear down upon the barn, their wings neither white wax nor marble. So they have been recorded. Burnished, literal in the composed air, they raise their harps above the beasts likewise gathering, the lambs and all the startled silken chickens. And Joseph, off to one side, has touched his cheek, meaning he is weeping. But how small he is, withdrawn from the hollow of his mother's life, the raw flesh bound in linen, as the stars yield light to delight his sense, for whom there is no ornament. Please remain seated for our next song. I want you to take a moment in the quiet to read to yourselves the next poem in your bulletin. This poem is called A Ritual to Read to Each Other. So I invite those of you who are comfortable doing so to read along with me, and the others, read along with us in your hearts. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world,
and following the wrong God, we may miss our star. For there is many a small betrayal in the mind, a shrug that lets the fragile sequence break, sending with shouts the horrible errors of childhood storming out to play through the broken dike. And as elephants parade, holding each elephant's tail, but if one wanders, the circus won't find the park. I call it cruel, and maybe the root of all cruelty, to know what occurs, but not recognize the fact. And so I appeal to a voice, something shadowy, a remote, important region in all who talk. Though we could fool each other, we should consider, lest the parade of our mutual life get lost in the dark. For it is important that awake people be awake, or a breaking mind may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes or no, or maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep.
In order to count how many people there were so that he could tax them, the emperor told everyone to go to their hometowns and to be counted. So Joseph went with Mary, his fiancée, who was expecting a baby at any time, from Nazareth to Bethlehem. His family was descended from King David, and King David had lived in Bethlehem. While they were there, Mary delivered a baby boy, wrapped him up tight, and laid him in a feed trough in the barn, where they were staying because the inns were full.
Meanwhile in the fields, shepherds were watching their sheep during the night. All of a sudden, an angel stood right in front of them, and God's glory was shining all around them, and they were scared to death. The angel told them not to be afraid, because there was only good news. This news is so good, the angel said, that everyone will be happy. Today, in the city of David, the Savior whom everyone's been waiting for was born. I want you to go find him. Here's how you'll know he's the right baby. He'll be lying in a feed trough, all wrapped up in strips of cloth.
When the angel said that, the skies burst into song, and the angels filled up the entire sky, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to those on earth whom God loves."
When the angels had gone back to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem and find this baby boy they were talking about." So they ran and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in the feed trough, just as the angel had told them. They told Mary and Joseph what the angel had said about who this child was and would become. Everyone was amazed at their story, but Mary kept this entire story in her heart. The shepherds praised God for all that had happened that night and went back to their sheep.
Our next hymn is number 230, A Little Town.
Thank you.
the words of the prophet Isaiah. Let us remember them as we read responsibly. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in a pitch dark land, light has dawned. You have made the nation great. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as those who divide plunder rejoice. On the day of Midian, you've shattered the yoke that burdened them, the staff on their shoulders, and the rod of their oppressor. Because every boot of the thundering warriors and every garment rolled in blood will be burned, fuel for the fire. A child is born to us, a son is given to us, and authority will be on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be vast authority and endless peace for David's throne and for his kingdom, establishing and sustaining it with justice and righteousness, now and forever. The Lord of heavenly forces will do this. Amen. Please pray with me. Eternal God, by the birth of Jesus Christ, you gave yourself to the world. Grant that being born in our hearts, he may save us from all our sins and restore within us the image and likeness of our Creator, to whom be everlasting praise and glory, world without end. Amen. If you've been in church for many years, or even visited different kinds of church, you may have heard a traditional creed in which you would find the words begotten, not made, to describe Jesus. Begotten, not made. In a creed that had to be short enough to be memorable, to be able to be carried without notes to refer to, but also big enough to encompass all of our faith, these words made the final cut. Begotten, not made. A creed, just like a poem, has to be so much bigger than the number of characters within it. If you are an avid tweeter, you might know a little bit about how this creative process goes. Every word has to be bigger than its most surface literal meaning. And begotten, not made, is just like this. It means that God, in human form, Jesus, this amazing sage and teacher, the physical form of grace, touching our lives and going before us to make the ultimate symbol of God's love for us in the crucifixion, breaking down all of those barriers between us and freedom, was made like us. And from the very same stuff as us, Jesus was born from a person, made a person, a human being, but also out of the same stuff as God. made from the same stuff as us, but also the same stuff as God. One of the things that we learn in seminary is that for centuries, people argued about how this could be possible. Churches split over it. It doesn't make sense. It's a contradiction. How can Jesus be flesh and bone and also very God? True God of true God. It's a contradiction. It's the kind of contradiction that poems are full of, where you have two truths side by side that seem to say different things, even opposite things, and yet coexist. The way that we use our language involves so much creativity because the flatness of things does not describe the whole of our experience. Right? We play with words. We play with symbols. We play with meanings, trying to reach at what is behind the surface. This is the night where we remember that long night of waiting and watching and wondering at the mystery that was all that God has promised to us. And at the end of that long night, an instant where something happened. And the people who came close to it could feel it, but didn't know how to tell us what it is. We don't sing just one carol. We don't read just one word on a night like this because it is too big for just the surface of the story. Poems are full of contradictions and symbols. I found myself thinking about poetry because as I was meditating on this story that takes place on this night, this instant, this symbol of Jesus born among us, I kept remembering this poem that I memorized when I was a young girl. I read it in a book. It was a character's favorite poem. Then it became my favorite poem, and I carried it around with me on my skin for many years. And the longer I've walked with it, the more it's revealed to me. Scripture does this too, right? Some little nugget, the longer you carry it, the more it accrues, right? The more wisdom we find in it. The poem was not written on the surface about God. It was written as a love poem. But God is love. It's the poem, "He Wishes for the Claws of Heaven," by William Butler Yeats. These are the words. "Had I the heaven's embroidered claws, inwrought with a golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark claws of night, and light and half-light, I would spread the claws under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams." As I've been carrying this poem around in my heart and on my skin, I've realized that this poem describes so well the difference between the light and dark used in the poetry of these passages, the passage from the prophet Isaiah we just read, and the light and dark we experience in our world. There is a common misconception that when we call Christ the light of the world, that means that God and Christ are only in places that are light. And light has a lot of meanings attached to it, right? Light can mean easy. Light can mean happy. Light can mean celebration. Light can mean warm and comfortable. having enough. Darkness can mean cold. Darkness can mean the inability to see. Darkness can mean separation or sadness or heaviness of spirit. This is the flexibility, the poetry of our language. And yet in this poem, the language means something else too. The poet says, if I had the heaven's embroidered claws, all inwrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark claws of night and light and half-light. This describes even the darkness of night or moments of twilight as shot through with gold and silver. But the night that we see here is not the complete absence of light. It's the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of heaven. For me, this poem goes in even to the darkness of my spirit and my soul. In those places where I feel completely dark inside, where there seems to be no joy and no celebration, I remember, because of this poem, that even those places are shot through with gold and silver. Even those places are not existing in the absence of light. They are the blue and the dim, part of heaven's embroidered cloths. If I had these cloths, I would spread them under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. If I imagine that God is the poet, that God is the poor one giving this poem of love to us, and I believe that that is what God does. That is what this story is. That is what it means that we are gathered here around the symbol, the witness, the life story of Jesus. It's a love poem. If God is the poet, the cloths and the dreams, how different are they? How different are they? The poet seems to think that the claws of heaven are the greatest thing that can be given. And yet, if God is the speaker of the poem, they're only one piece of creation. The dreams of God are even greater. God came in the form of a poor one, a helpless child, born in poverty and need. I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. God, called the Word, has come among us to spread God's dreams under our feet. On the fifth day of creation, God separated the light into small lights, lights to rule over the day and night, to serve as our moon and stars. God decreed that these lights, these separate lights, would mark the seasons and separate them from each other for us. This means that on that day, God created time and memory. Time and memory gives us a night like this, where the past and the present collide into a story, a multi-layered poem, full of richness and beauty and wisdom. In so many of the hymns that we are singing tonight, we are calling God, Jesus, our morning star. There's the cliche that the darkest hour is just before the dawn. And when does the morning star appear? When does the morning star appear? This is the bright light. The gold and silver threads shot through our darkest hours. I want to invite you on this night, in this silence we have created, in this creativity we have explored, to quiet your hearts, go into your internal thinking place, and imagine a single thread, a golden or a silver thread, shot through your life, shot through your darkness. Picture it there. God of glory, your splendor shines from a manger in Bethlehem into the darkness of human light. Open our eyes to Christ's presence in the shadows of our world, so that we, like him, may become beacons of your justice and defenders of all for whom there is no room. Amen. children of this amazing, contradictory God who shows up in our midst. Go, clinging to that thread shot through your life, and bear that light to the world.